We stay on the topic of wind generation. The next presenter is Ulash Karagak from Hong Kong Polytechnic University. And his presentation is entitled Safe Operation of DFIG-Based Wind Parks in Series Compensated Systems.
It's nice to meet you here. So the topic is safe operation of DFIG-based wind parks in series compensated system. So we will discuss about the SSCI phenomena in series compensated DFIG-based wind parks in this talk. And then we discuss about the identification methods. We discuss about the wind park operating conditions and DFIG control system parameters on SSCI. And then we will discuss about its mitigation without any additional investment, just modifying the DFIG control parameters. And we will also discuss about the future work. So the whenever the system is series compensated, then the electrical network resonant frequency fall below the synchronous frequency. So whenever you excite the system, then with that frequency, there will be some transients. As it is below the synchronous frequency, it is called subsynchronous frequency. If we consider a machine, it can be synchronous or asynchronous machine. Here, we consider the asynchronous machine as asynchronous machine is a part of the typical DFIG. So for the subsynchronous frequencies, the speed is, if it is synchronous machine, then the speed is at synchronous, so above the subsynchronous. Typically, the wind parks, the speed is much above the subsynchronous frequency range. Therefore, the rotor resistance is negative. So if there is no control on the induction machine, then it is the typical induction generator effect, SSR, subsynchronous resonance condition. On the other hand, the DFIG controls, especially the rotor side converter controls, has significant impact on the rotor resistance, the negative rotor resistance. Therefore, we call this phenomena SSCI, subsynchronous control interaction. It can take place with other any power electronic based equipment, not necessarily the DFIG. It is simply the interaction between the series capacitor and the control system. However, in here, the mechanism is quite different. Therefore, many people also fall this problem into the induction generator effect. What are the identification tools? Actually, those are the frequency scan analysis. Actually, it's a very old approach to identify the problem in a large-scale network, which occurred in the conventional power plants. We call it simply subsynchronous resonance, the torsional interaction, the interaction between the mechanical part of the conventional steam turbines and the series capacitor in the system compensated line or lines. Other approach is small signal analysis. The eigenvalue analysis and the impedance model-based analysis fall into this category. Eigenvalue analysis typically used for mitigation design. So actually not for identification, but mainly it's used for design mitigation, design countermeasures against SSCI. And the other one is the electromagnetic transient simulations. Of course, those simulations have quite significant cost whenever you have a large-scale network. On the other hand, the outputs of the previous approach should be validated or at least correlated with the EMP type studies, as it provides the ultimate accuracy in the simulation. Here we consider a quite simple network. We have a wind park over there, consists of 400 wind turbines with 1.5 megawatt power. We use the aggregated model in this study. So we consider a single wind turbine that represents the entire wind turbines inside the wind park, and it's connected to two separate strong system with one of them the connections is uncompensated, other is 50% compensated, series compensated line. It's fixed compensation. And the compensation is performed at the both ends of the line using the identical capacitors. And if you check the frequency scan seen from the aggregated DFIG terminal, the system has a, as you see, a resonance at around 33 hertz. There is a crossover in X, and that crossover actually creates the problem in our system. So let's first go with the eigenvalue analysis. Of course, it is difficult to perform in a large-scale network eigenvalue analysis. Usually, you have to reduce the system. You may represent a couple of bus bars around. So here we did further simplification, which is actually the general practice. For example, we take out the transformers, etc. We represent all of them with single RLC branches, as shown in the figure. As it is the linearized model, of course, it regards certain dynamics. It's in DQ reference frame. For that reason, it is not possible to account for measuring input filters, their impact on SSCI, as well as the PLL dynamics. On the other hand, this is the traditional approach. It is possible to include those parts inside the model with describing an additional DQ reference frame different from the electrical side for the control system. So we perform the eigenvalue analysis one by one and check the impact of wind park operating conditions on SSCI mode. As shown over here, as the wind speed decreases, then the severity of the problem or the potential possibility of SSCI appearance increase. It also changed quite significant with the wind turbine outage scenarios. On the other hand, as shown in the first figure, the reactive power generation at the wind park has almost no impact on SSCI. What about the wind turbine control, the DFIG control parameters? The first figure illustrates the impact of rotor side converter inner loop rise time. So with the decrease in the rise time, the system becomes vulnerable to SSCI. It's shown for different wind speeds as well on the same graph. So if you reduce the rise time or make the system faster, then it becomes more vulnerable to SSCI. Note that one can propose that, okay, let's increase the rise time, then solve the problem. On the other hand, we need a certain, beside the you know, the system stability, we need a certain speed of response due to fault right through requirements, which exist in many grid codes. Then we check the impact of the voltage regulator gain. It has a positive impact. If you increase the gain, then the system becomes more immune to the SSCI. However, its impact is not that significant like the inner loop parameters. It should be noted that the outer loop parameters are disregarded in certain studies because of their less impact on SSCI. When we check the grid side converter parameters, it has almost no impact on SSCI. So in summary, the wind speed, the wind turbine outage scenarios has significant impact on SSCI. On the other hand, the reactive power generation has no impact. When we consider the DFIG parameters, the rotor side control parameters has significant impact. On the other hand, the grid side converter parameters has no impact, and especially the inner current control parameters have significant impact on SSCI. What about the measuring filters? We are not able to check whether it has an impact on SSCI or not, similar to that, the PLL dynamics. One important thing about this approach, actually, you need the complete model of the system. So in a way, with the manufacturer models, you cannot use this approach, or you cannot design anything because it's black box. Then we perform some EMTP RE simulations. Actually, the results with the eigenvalue analysis, the outputs are correlated, but there is a quite significant difference between the results, the damping of the SSI mode. Over here, the scenarios from 1 to 5, the wind speed is decreased from 1 per unit until 0.6. So as shown over here, for the wind speeds 0.7, 0.6, the system is unstable. On the other hand, when we check the eigenvalue analysis results, the system looks stable. So in a way, they are correlated, but the values, the damping values, are quite different. So this is the impact of the reactive power generation. As shown over here, it has almost no impact. The SSI mode has quite similar damping in those cases. And the wind turbine outage scenarios, it is also correlated with the eigenvalue simulation results. On the other hand, the damping is in general much low compared to the eigenvalue analysis results. They are correlated, but the damping values are much lower what we observed during the EMP simulations. And similarly, we also performed the time domain simulations for the to show the impact of the rotor side converter rise time for different values. And they are all correlated with the eigenvalue results, but the damping values are much smaller. So to see the impact of the input measuring filters, actually, we perform a couple of simulations. So the wind speed is 0.8. There is no wind turbine outage in this scenario. And we change the order of the filter as well as the cutoff frequency of the filter. So as shown over here, it has a significant impact. If you remove the filters inside the system, then your results becomes quite close to the eigenvalue analysis results. So the phase shift at the, as we mentioned, we use the DQ reference frame. On the other hand, there's a phase shift in the measuring filters. So the DQ reference frame of the electrical system and the control system are different. And this difference has such a significant impact on SSCI mode. Therefore, to be able to use eigenvalue analysis to identify the accurate correct prediction of the SSCI risk, then the traditional model needs to be modified, improved to account for the input filters, which requires also two separate reference frames, one for the electrical system, one for the control system. So you may ask why the eigenvalue analysis are outputs good, let's say, damping controllers. because we are using it for such purposes. The reason is that actually we put very large margin. So we shift the system modes a lot to the safe side. Therefore, the impact of input filters becomes not noticeable in that case due to the very large, let's say, stability margin that is put in the design as a design constraint. And other tool is the frequency scan. Actually, frequency scan is an old technique. On the other hand, for the power electronic-based devices, we have to obtain the frequency response characteristic through the EMP type simulations. So in that case, we simply simulate the, for example, for these simulations, we put the DFIG, we put the system equivalent, and we perform time domain simulations. During the, those simulations, we inject current at the low voltage bus. It can be done also by injecting voltage as well. On the other hand, the, it will be in series to the grid side voltage. And we should perform time domain simulations for each frequency. Note that we use here the sinusoidal excitation. Actually, it is possible to get rid of simulating the system for each frequency by using other type signals, such as white noise. On the other hand, according to experiences in Iraq, they recommended me to go with the sinusoidal excitation. Therefore, we actually write a script for that purpose. It performed the simulation for each frequency. And also, we inside the script, we also modify the certain parameters in the simulation. Here, it is important to use large excitation signal. However, to obtain good results, on the other hand, it shouldn't activate any transient function or activate any nonlinearity inside the DFIG controls or in the electrical system as well. Therefore, its selection is quite tricky. What we did, actually, we inject around 1 per unit current in magnitude. And whenever it activates a certain transient function, we detect it and we simply reduce it with a certain percentage and repeat the simulation. So also here, I want to mention about that. This technique had been proposed long time ago, just after the ERCOT event. So, however, the criteria, assessment criteria was not accurate. It was recommended to perform the grid side simulation frequency scan and the turbine size frequency scan separately and do the assessment based on these two separate scan results. On the other hand, actually, when you consider the entire system, the complete system, both contribute to the resonant conditions. Therefore, you have to account both of them. We have to add these values up to obtain the characteristics of the system. Here, as shown, we simply add the wind turbine side impedance to the grid side impedance. And over here, we check the crossover, reactance crossover. We check for the resistance and also the frequency. It should be noted that the resonance frequency is same with the time domain simulations and very close to the eigenvalue simulation result. So, for example, for the base case, as you see, the resistance is positive. Therefore, there is no SSCI risk. On the other hand, if we apply the previous assessment or, let's say, criteria for prediction of SSCI, as shown over here, the wind turbine has negative subsynchronous negative resistance for the subsynchronous range greater than 15 hertz. So any resonant condition at the grid site larger than 15 hertz is supposed to generate an instability. However, it's not the case in time domain simulations and also with the new criteria. So we perform perform the combined scan approach to assess the to check the potential interaction risk for different wind speeds, and we obtain consistent results with the time domain simulations. For example, for the first two scenario over here, this is the basic case that I already presented, and those are the other simulation scenarios, S2 and S3. The system is stable because at the reactance crossover, the resistances are positive. On the other hand, for the other two scenario, for the wind speed 0.7 and 0.6, the system is unstable. And what about the filters? Can we see the impact of the filters? Yeah, we can see over there. It has a significant impact. The order of the filter and the also the cutoff frequency, it with the increase in the order or decrease in the cutoff frequency, the turbine resistance becomes smaller. So it means that with the increase in the order, you simply increase the phase shift. With the reduction in the cutoff frequency, it has also the same impact. You simply increase the phase shift at the filter. And if we perform the combined scan for with the obtained parameter waveforms in here, if we add them up to the grid site frequency scan, we obtain same results with the time domain simulation. So it's extremely accurate. So based on these results, actually, we propose a guideline for tuning the DFIG parameters for safe operation. So we should consider, of course, the slowest permissible wind speed, because with the wind speed, decrease in the wind speed, the SSCI risk increase. It's the expected case. We should consider some extreme wind turbine outage scenarios, because wind turbine outage has significant impact on SSCI, so we should check it and consider the worst scenario. And also, we should consider the highest effective compensation degree. Actually, it is in here, it's a quite simple system. So the compensation degree is fixed. We have the line. So what can be changed in this case? Only the system equivalent. It may change due to outage, but it does not have negative impact on SSCI. However, there might be some investments, new additional lines or generators, etc. If that value decrease, in that case, the effective compensation increase. Therefore, we have to consider the upcoming projects, the network expansion plans, and consider the possible highest effective compensation degree. So as we already mentioned, that we can simply increase the rotor side converter current control rise time to improve the damping. On the other hand, it will have a negative impact on the response time. So we should compensate it with the voltage regulator, increasing the voltage regulator gain for the desired performance. And also while tuning the, while for the filters, measuring filters, it should be good to avoid the high order filters, and we have to select the highest possible cutoff frequency. It also changes with the, you know, the sampling frequency, etc. So it depends on the system. So it is good to select as high as possible. So over here, this is the fault right through requirements. So actually, the amount of current is identified the minimum during severe voltage sags or swell. And also the rise time should be smaller than 20. Therefore, if we increase then. However, if we increase with that the voltage regulator gain, in such a case, you will be at the upper side of this curve, so it's okay for the utility. At the activation time, if you consider then the amount, when you consider the minimum amount, then it is okay. We performed a couple of simulations. It is one of those, actually, for different rise time, as well as for different voltage regulator gains. Of course, it is apparent with the increase in the rotor side converter rise time, it becomes slower. On the other hand, if we simply increase the voltage regulator gain, then the reactive current is always above the initial reactive current. So then it simply satisfies the grid code requirement in that sense. So it is easy to tune a DFIG type wind turbine to get rid of the potential SSI problem. So we propose new settings like, you know, we increase from 20 millisecond to 30 millisecond the rotor side converter rise time. And we also increase the voltage regulator gain from 2 to 2.2. We reduce the filter order from 4 to 2, and we simply double the cutoff frequency. And now the system becomes stable with the new settings. And also this is confirmed with the time domain simulations as well. And the damping is much better compared to, because we also designed some controllers for this system, which use the, actually the certain outputs of the, like the currents of the DFIG rotor side and grid side converters, as well as it has an observer. So on the other hand, such it is easy to implement on the, you know, model, and also we use aggregated system. On the other hand, if you want to implement it in a real wind park, then you have to usually implement it at the secondary loop of the system, the wind park. You have to communicate with wind turbines, etc. So it needs high rate data transfer, and it is vulnerable to potential communication delays, so it needs several words. So only designing with the aggregated model is not the part. So that type of solution needs actually further research. So however, like that, right now we did this work with Samyon. Samyon start using this approach in their wind turbines that are close to the series compensated systems. So what are the future work? Actually, we already completed the first one, the EMT simulation-based frequency scan module. So it will be a part of a part of the EMTP library. You simply put it and it will repeat the simulations for the frequency range that is specified by the user with the, and it automatically output the characteristics. This will be ready very soon. And also we are actually both, it's not only the implementation but also the theoretical part. We are working on a efficient SSI screening tool for very large scale power system. So we are working on how to model the as the power electronic devices inside such a system, and how to make the prediction of potential problems. It should be noted that this will not only identify the problems with the series capacitor network and the DFIG. So we will use this tool to predict SSR between a wind turbine generator and series capacitor, subsynchronous torsional interaction problem between a wind turbine generator and any power electronic converter. It can be It happened recently, for example, in China, a conventional power plant has a torsional interaction problem with the solar, large solar-based converters. So, therefore, our tool will detect not only a specific problem, but also it can be used for any subsynchronous interaction problems. And also, it should be noted that not necessarily at the subsynchronous range, we can also extend its usage to identify potential problems between power electronic-based devices. For example, two wind parks, or a wind park and the HVDC terminal. So, or a wind park or HVDC terminal and a FACTS device. So it will be used for identifying any type of control interaction problem or subsynchronous interaction problem. And right now we are working on that. And also, of course, one major output of this work will be comprehensive realistic benchmarks for SSI research. That includes that type issues in certain scenarios, operating scenarios or output scenarios, etc. So many thanks for your attention.
Hi, this is Ramesh. When you modeled the wind turbine for the control interaction study, did you also aggregate the cable models as well, or it was directly just a wind machine with the transformer?
Exactly. In this system, actually, if we consider here, I didn't go into the details, the wind park model. Actually, normally, of course, when you consider a wind park, there it's connected to the transmission system to a transformer. You have a medium voltage collector with the cables, and you know, and other side is the GFIG included is the transformer low voltage, the medium voltage. So here we use aggregation for the inside internal network as well. Yeah, for the internal network as well. So for the cable network inside, it's represented with pi section.
Okay. The other question I have is, you said that it has, the subsynchronous control interaction had no impact with the reactive power output coming out of the wind machine. So were you also operating it in voltage control mode, or what kind of control mode were you putting it in?
How it is working, if we consider the entire wind park, actually, the reactive power is controlled with a two-stage controller, or let's say a two-level controller. At the primary level, the wind turbine simply controls its output voltage through a proportional controller. On the other hand, the reference signal, let's say, comes from the wind park controller, which is a PI regulator. And regulates the reactive power at the point of interconnection and produce the reference signals for the wind turbines and distribute that signal to the each turbine. So we directly implement that approach in here. We also, the wind park controller has power factor control or the voltage control mode as well. We only consider in this study the Q control. In the other options, again, that PI regulator, reactive power regulator, is also used because the voltage control mode, it's additional proportional controller that produce for the reactive power regulator, the reference signal, the reactive power reference signal. So it is quite similar to the you know, European origin wind turbines, and similar to the Senmyon, actually, system.
The reason why I'm asking, why I ask the question is, when you're putting, means what kind, when you're applying a fault, mm-hmm. specifically when which excites your resonant frequency and goes into an unstable feeding, had you put it in voltage control mode, would it have reacted in a different way? Would it have a more sensitivity to the reactive power output.
Actually, over here, if you consider the let's say widely used generic models, actually it has some issues about its control. It has two modes. One is the voltage control, which is a PI regulator that actually regulates the DFIG terminal, let's say, and other is the reactive power control, which regulates the reactive power output. It should be noted that the reactive power or the voltage should be controlled at the point of interconnection, at the transmission system level. Because, for example, you cannot dispatch the reactive power because of the losses inside the wind park. Therefore, here, for example, let's consider the reactive power control over there. Therefore, it measures the reactive power and, you know, generate the reference signal to produce at the other side, at the wind turbine side. The wind turbine side, the control, actually, it is quite similar to the frequency control thing. You know, like the group characteristic, it is simply the voltage regulator gain, and it simply adjusts its reactive power output by changing the terminal voltage set point, the second, the wind park controller. So if you like, actually, this is not my computer. The other options, it is always the proportion control at the wind, proportional voltage control at the wind turbine side. There is no other option. If you consider the wind park side, over there you have PI reactive power regulator. If it is operating under reactive power control mode, then it's like that. If it is operating under power factor control, then the reference signal for the reactive power is automatically identified by the selected power factor and the output of the, you know, the wind park. If it is voltage control, in that case, there is a proportional controller just before the reactive power regulator, the PI regulator, which is quite slow, actually, not fast. And it generates the reactive, reference reactive power with a proportional controller. And it simply receives the voltage reference, compare the voltage at the measuring point, and generates the reactive power reference through a proportional control. So in this scheme, we only consider the reactive power control at the point of interconnection and disregard the others. One reason is that actually the PI regulator has very slow response. So in a way, we didn't see much impact on that in general. We did a couple of simulations, but didn't go further.
Ulash, thank you very much. Can you comment on the difficulties of deriving the DQ0 models of the wind turbine and the one on the side of the network? There are many, many people that have this trend that they think we can build a simulator based on DQ0 approach. And what is your opinion on that?
Actually, DQ0 approach, first of all, for this specific case, as you are not able to, you know, build the input filters, then you won't be able to obtain the good results for this specific case. On the other hand, you know, it's also, it has some other issues in DQ, the time domain simulator, you said, no?
Yeah.
Yeah, but what will be the advantage, actually, if you have unbalanced system? For the balanced system, it has a significant advantage. They become DC, so you can use very large time steps.
I agree.
But for unbalanced system, in such a case, even you have to use a smaller time step because it maps the certain frequencies far from the. So even 50 hertz becomes, you know, for example, consider a 60 hertz system. Mm-hmm. If you have an unbalanced system, then you have to reduce further because it maps to double frequency a certain part and a certain part to the, you know, the negative frequency becomes, it is mapped to the
double also frequency. The derivation is not simple. It requires a lot of.
If you want to, actually, one side is, as I mentioned, you know, the controls. Also, I don't know, representation of nonlinearities, it's also other challenge in DQ domain. It looks quite difficult unless you do certain simplifications, but it will be at the expense of the accuracy in that case. So it doesn't sound that logical. For this study, especially if you don't consider the impact of the input filters, then as shown here, they have quite significant impact. Or what can be done? You have to also consider the different DQ reference frame at each control part of the system. With that approach, it's possible to consider the filters, but it becomes very difficult.
Yeah, it can be done, but it's complicated.
It's complicated.
It requires more work.
There is no such work in the literature as well. Nobody do the eigenvalue analysis with such complicated models.
For the moment, your current source that you're injecting is positive sequence, right?
Yeah, positive sequence.
Did you try another approach? Or?
Yeah, actually, the other signals or the negative sequence and others, you mean? Actually, the positive sequence we only consider because the other will not result, you know, the problem inside the machine. Here, the unlike the other, you know, the power electronic-based devices, therefore it's discussion. The interaction is between the machine and the series capacitor. So the control has only impact on the rotor resistance. But the interacting is the machine itself. So if you consider the negative sequence, then you know it becomes supersynchronous frequency. So it does not result any problem inside the machine. So we didn't consider about it.
Final question, do you think you can use this technique to derive the mechanical modes of a synchronous machine?
Yeah, of course. We also, but one issue is that actually I tried for that as well for synchronous machine because my intention is to extend this approach, the frequency scanning.
Because it's often demanded, you know.
To include all types of subsynchronous interaction, not limited to the DFIG and the series capacitor system. For example, the potential interaction between HVDC and the mechanical modes of a turbine. Yeah, you can actually, if you perform scan, you obtain very accurately the modes. On the other hand, one thing is that you have to decrease the time step a lot because it changed very suddenly.
But that's all right. I mean, once we have the modes, it's okay. You don't do it often. You just do it once, you know. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.